Hi, my name is Joseph Kay, and I'm Associate Professor of Pediatrics and Medicine at the CU School of Medicine in Colorado's Adult and Teen Congenital Heart Disease Program Director here at both Children's Hospital Colorado and University of Colorado Hospital. As many of you know, congenital heart disease is the most common birth defect, affecting slightly more than 1 in 100 infants. While many of those with simple or what we call low complex congenital heart disease are often not identified until adolescence or adulthood, most moderate and complex congenital heart disease required usually surgical treatment within the first 1 or 2 years of life. Before the 1990s, mortality for neonatal and infant heart surgery remained very high, slightly higher than 25%. However, with improved diagnosis, as well as surgical and postoperative ICU care, within the new millennium, the mortality has dramatically dropped to lower than 5%, and in some lesions, as low as 1 or 2%. So while there is no significant change in the birth rate of congenital heart disease, the prevalence of adults defined by those greater than or equal to 18 years of age has more than doubled in the previous decades. However, very few of these young adults should be considered cured. And in fact, when our colleagues in the Netherlands looked at mortality rate for all patients within that country with congenital heart disease, comparing to patients without congenital heart disease, they saw that throughout the spectrum, there's a significantly higher mortality. What they learned when they looked at their data a little bit more carefully, about 3/4 of the cause of mortality was cardiac and vascular in nature, where only 25% of them were related to non-cardiac issues such as malignancies or trauma. Well, why is that? One of the reasons in the most complex cyanotic congenital heart defect that we have is tetralogy of Fallot, is really the frequency of arrhythmias and heart failure. Here we look at this graph of survivors with tetralogy of Fallot, and as they age, the percentage of those that have issues with either heart failure or arrhythmias dramatically goes up. In a study that we were part of looking at adult patients with tetralogy of Fallot in academic centers throughout the country, the prevalence of arrhythmias dramatically goes up in the third and fourth decade of life. When we look at an important study from our colleagues in Quebec, we see that after the Canadian Medical Society published the recommendation that all patients cared for with congenital heart disease should be in subspecialty centers, they had seen in extended follow-up that the mortality actually dropped. When they looked more carefully at risk factors for death, there were some common themes, as we expected, that those with multiple comorbidities and a higher mortality, as well as those with very complex severe congenital heart disease. What was surprising, though, at the top shows that those seen and cared for in the subspecialty ACHD centers had a lower mortality. And when compared to those that were seen either in the community or with mixed care defined as those that were seen both in the ACHD centers and the community, mortality was higher. And this mortality increases over time, as seen in this Kaplan-Meier survival curve. So the longer a patient is in a referral center care, the lower mortality is expected. When we looked in a multi-center evaluation of patients that make it into ACHD center care in the United States, we wanted to see how many of them had a significant gap. And this slide shows that, particularly in Colorado, but many centers, the majority of patients had a significant gap in care. So what makes an ACHD center? Well, certainly the ACHD providers are important, and they're the coordinators in much of the care, but they are by far not the majority of what happens behind the scenes. We need the transition coordinators to make sure that patients understand lifelong care is important, The congenital cardiac surgeons are extremely important, as studies have shown that mortality on ACHD patients operated by congenital surgeons is less than when operated by non-congenital surgeons. ACHD-trained non-invasive cardiologists were experts both in advanced imaging such as CT and MRI, as well as congenital heart disease, are critical, as well as physicians who have experience in advanced therapies through the cardiac cath lab, as well as expertise in congenital heart disease, experts in both electrophysiology and congenital heart disease, as well as perinatologists, since many of these patients will go on to have their own children, psychiatrists and psychologists, because many of these patients do have a lot of anxiety, depression because of their disease that they've had since birth. Social workers are very important to help our patients and us navigate the complex maze of our healthcare system and heart failure and transplant. So the Adult Congenital Heart Association has developed a program certification program of which has over 96 criteria that programs need to fulfill in order to receive accreditation. Some of the highlights of these are at least 2 board certified ACHD physicians to provide 24/7 coverage, 2 congenital board certified surgeons also to provide 24/7 coverage, as well as a nurse practitioner, a nurse coordinator dedicated only to the ACHD patients, a social worker for at least half of their time dedicated to the ACHD patients, a formal transition program, access to transplant, as well as process of quality insurance to make sure we improve year to year. Currently, there's about 35 programs that have received this accreditation throughout the United States through the ACHE program. As you can see in this graph, the United States, however, west of the Mississippi, only about 11 programs have received accreditation. So this does mean many patients in our part of the country need to travel long distances to receive appropriate care. Well, one of the most common conditions in congenital heart disease that we treat are patients who have abnormal pulmonary valves, such as those with tetralogy of Fallot, truncus arteriosus, or congenital pulmonary valve stenosis. Over time, they may need multiple open heart surgeries to replace failing bioprosthetic valves. This slide shows that the average lifespan of these valves when placed in adults is only about 15 years, so many of these patients would be facing multiple surgeries. Exciting technology that have developed and is usually only in these centers of excellence is transcatheter valve insertion. The first valve that we had available is made by Medtronic called the Melody valve, which has its limitations, was approved by the FDA in 2010, but is limited to only patients who have a failing valve previously implanted anywhere from 18 to 22 millimeters. Fortunately, newer technology has come online, and this valve, manufactured by Edwards, the Sapien XT, was approved in 2016 for implantation in the pulmonary position. And this allowed providers to implant valves, and even larger valves, that previously we couldn't. New exciting technology that we have in many other centers throughout the country is what's called the Edwards Altera valve. This is a research device that is undergoing a multi-center research trial for patients with very dilated right ventricular outflow tracts to allow transcatheter insertion of a pulmonary valve without surgery. What this system allows is even patients with very dilated right ventricular outflow tract, particularly those with previous tetralogy of Fallot treatments, up to 36 millimeters, we can place this transcatheter system in place, and despite even sometimes a very irregular outflow track, this more rigid system will make it more uniform and round and allow for a transcatheter Sapien valve to be implanted within this docking station. So we hope that the majority of patients now need a new pulmonary valve systems. We can avoid multiple repeat open heart surgeries. Because of the long distance many of our patients have to seek care with us, we have been blessed and been able to expand our clinic presence to Montana, multiple sites in Wyoming, as well as northern, southern, and western Colorado. So hopefully, if you have a patient that needs to be seen by us, they can be seen locally in one of our outreach clinics. So for more information or to contact us, please visit us on our website. Thank you.